This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
It is a scorching day in the African bush, and over here we have some zebra taking shelter in the shade. This is Safari Live. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Safari Live on our Sunset Safari. My name's Byron, and on camera this afternoon is Brian with the thumb, and we've got a hedgehog thumb this afternoon. Different, very different. And the other vehicle is Taylor and Dave. They're heading down to Cheetah Plains. And then in the FC, we've got Kirsten. It's great to have you all with us, and welcome again. As I said, it is a scorching day today. It is about 37 degrees Celsius, or about 98 degrees Fahrenheit, so very, very hot. And we've just got some zebra and impala that have moved into the shade off to my left. You can see these animals are all affected by the heat, and they are very, very clever, and they adapt well to these conditions. They'll move into the shade and spend most of the time, or during the day, walking around, feeding, and then later on probably heading towards some water and getting a drink. Those impala are beautiful, wonderful antelope. So this afternoon we are actually in search for some lions. We managed to get a glimpse of some lions this morning. We had two females and a male from the Unkuhuma Pride. It was wonderful to see them, and you can see clear blue skies. Really a wonderful day here today. So we're in search of lions. It's very hot, so I'm hoping they haven't moved too far. Possibly in around these drainage lines that we're going to drive through now, and I'm going to search very carefully. And while I do that, let's go over to Taylor so she can say afternoon to you.
Welcome to a sweltering afternoon here in the African wilderness. Look at these beautiful elephants that we have found. Now, it's just a small group of them. They seem to just be three over here. You can have a look at that tiny little one, and even the adult female is exhausted from this heat. She's drinking water very, very slowly, as you can see, not really rushing her time, trying to spend as much time at this watering hole as she can. There she goes, she tilts her head back and has a little drink. Now, hello again, of course. My name is Taylor, in case you've just joined us for the first time, and on camera with me we've got David. There he is. And we are so lucky to be able to sit and watch this incredible, beautiful beast of an animal just slowly try and cool herself down. Let's see if she's going to perhaps spray some water on herself. It seems as though they have already had a mud bath, and it's been hot since early this morning, since just before we ended the sunrise safari. And I reckon that the elephants probably will be having a bath at any opportunity they really can get. So lucky for them, there's all those mud wallows around, and they're able to cool themselves down quite nicely. Now remember, we are on a live safari, and I'd love to hear from you, and I'm sure Byron would love to get some questions from anyone that's watching today. So you are welcome to do so by either hashtagging Safari Live on Twitter, or alternatively you could even send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. Now my plan this afternoon is to actually go back across to Cheetah Plains, and I'd like to try and follow up on those leopards. And hopefully, with all the water that is on Cheetah Plains, all those beautiful pans, maybe we'll see some buffalo and some more elephants in the water. I suspect a bit later we should see things like zebra and impala, wildebeest maybe even, all coming down for a little drink. Now, this pan that we're looking at the moment is a natural pan. So this is all the water that fell from the sky the other evening. And you can see it filled it up right to the top. There was a small amount of water in, but it was drying quite quickly. Now, Wyatt, you were wondering this afternoon, if there were no borehole pumps and we weren't pumping water, how would some of the larger animals cope and find water? Now, elephants aren't really that badly affected because they are able to dig for their own water, so they can go to all those beautiful dry riverbeds that we often see and dig deep down into the sand, and beautiful fresh upwellings of water will come through. And also, the larger animals are very well adapted to migrating, so they would just do mini migrations and move further north or south and look for rivers that are still flowing. Now the problem comes in actually for the smaller animals, for something like a zebra, which is a water-dependent animal, or a waterbuck. And they never really move for about 5 kilometers away from a permanent water source. Now you can imagine if all the pans in the area dried up, it would be quite difficult for something like impala and waterbuck and, for instance, zebra to have to migrate maybe 50 or 60 kilometers away before they could find the next water source. So it's actually the bigger animals that are a little bit more well adapted. This one going right in, not wasting any time. If I were an elephant, this is the one that I'd be too. Standing right in the middle of the pool, trying to cool myself down as much as I could. And I do apologize, my aerial is in the way. And I want to say a very special welcome to all the children at Windsor Oaks Academy. Thank you so much for joining, and we look so forward to hearing from you. So remember, you can ask us questions and we'll try and answer them to the best of our ability. So if you have any questions about these elephants, send them through. It can be anything you like and we'll try and answer them. But let's go back to the real stars of the show and see that little one standing in the shade of Mom. And of course it will be benefiting from all the water that she's now spraying over the top of herself. Little one looks like it's trying to eat. Getting a couple of splashes on its trunk. I can't see from here if it's a girl or a boy. Hopefully if it moves around a little bit, then we'll be able to get a better view. It looks relatively young. It's probably less than about 6 months, or maybe almost 6 months old. Now, it is so hot here today. It is about 98 degrees Fahrenheit. I feel as though it feels even hotter than that. And tomorrow is going to be like sitting in an oven. Apparently, it's going to be probably about 105, maybe even a little bit more than that degree Fahrenheit, but we will see. Hopefully we get a unsuspecting thunderstorm that comes over and rejuvenates and cools us all down. Look at this little one, very carefully trying to pick at all the small leaves that are just starting to grow on that tree. Now you're using your trunk very well. Not hanging around though. Better get back to Mom's shade so you can stay nice and cool, little one. And of course, that elephant is not wanting to leave the water just yet. Very peaceful out here. Only a couple of robins singing in the distance. Now, Abby, you'd like to know, how do the elephants get the water in their mouth? If you watch them, look at those big trunks. They're almost like a straw. And what they'll do is that they'll suck the water up in their trunks. They can hold almost about 10 liters of water. And then they spray it back into their mouths. But now, this elephant is having a mud bath. And it's very important that the elephants cover themselves with lots of mud. And what that does is it cools them down nicely. It almost acts like a sun protection, like a sunscreen. And most importantly, is it suffocates all the little insects, so all the parasites that are trying to suck the elephant's blood. It'll basically make them stop breathing. And then the elephant will go and have a scratch on a nice tree. And hopefully those parasites, those insects that are feeding on the elephant's blood, that would have died, would have then be scraped off of the skin and onto the tree, giving a little head shake. Now we saw this elephant give a little stomp and a kick and a head shake. And I know that Hunter was wondering, why do elephants stomp their feet? Now, normally they don't stomp too much. Possibly there were some insects that were maybe irritating, maybe some flies or something that was biting the elephant. And that's why it was shaking its feet around like that. But you can see when it kicks its foot into the mud, it's trying to loosen all that soil. You see that lovely mixture of water and mud now? It wants the perfect sort of consistency. So it doesn't want it too watery. It wants it to be just perfect, just to form a nice sort of layer on the elephant's skin. And you can see they almost go a lovely chocolate brown color when they cover themselves with the mud. And shiny. It's like they've put glitter all over their bodies. And that little one getting quite curious now, coming over, possibly to an older sibling, brother or sister. Now, I said that that baby elephant is probably around 6 months old or so. And I know that Julian was wondering, how much does that baby elephant weigh? Now it probably weighs almost 150 kilograms, so quite a bit, well, just over 300 pounds. But I think that little one hasn't quite worked out how to spray the mud on itself yet. Haven't even seen it made an attempt yet to try and cover itself. But I think we're going to move on from these elephants now. We're going to try and head to go and find you all a leopard. Let's go back across to Byron and see how his search for the Nkuhumas is going.
It's not going very well at the moment. We're having a good look, but haven't seen any sign of these lions. We're moving through some really thick bush, but I assume they're hiding in the shade somewhere. A good afternoon and welcome to the kids from Windsor Oaks Elementary, Mrs. Cameron's class. Lovely to have you with us. Please don't forget, everyone, send us your questions at #SafariLive on Twitter, or email us questions@wildearth.tv. Okay, let's have a good look around here. I may have to walk around a little bit soon. Oh, wait. There's a marula over there. See, it's quite tricky, everyone, trying to maneuver through this bush. You can see all these trees. Our vehicles do take quite a beating while we're out here. Watch out, Brian. Hang on, what's this under the tree? Is that something there? It is, there we go, there's a lion. Look, everyone. Oh, that's a male. Oh, fantastic. And the rest of the pride. Well, at least two females just behind him. Oh, there we go. Just as I thought, hiding in the shade. Always wonder sometimes who's more intelligent, us or the animals. And at the moment, it's definitely the animals, because they're in the shade and we sitting out in the sun. I wonder where the rest of the pride is, if they are around this Nkuhuma pride that we see on Juma. It's a dominant pride around here, and territorial pride, and they've got cubs at the moment. So hopefully I get to show you the cubs. We'll spend some time here and we'll have a good look around, just trying to see if we can't maybe see anything down in this deep drainage line behind them. because I'm sure if there are other lions, they're probably hiding down there. It's nice and or much cooler. I'm just trying to have a look with my binoculars. See if I can't see a flick of a tail or an ear or anything to give me a sign that they're down there. So Daniel has asked us a question, and Daniel would like to know, why do lions roar? So Daniel, this big male lion especially will roar basically to mark his territory, to let other lions know that this is his home, or how we call it, his territory, to make sure that they don't come in and try and take that away from him and try and take the females away from him. So this male is part of a coalition called the Birmingham males. I almost forgot. Called the Birmingham males. And these males stay together, and together they're able to keep other males out of their territory. So that roaring, well, usually it's a way for them to communicate and find each other, but most of the time it's to mark their territory, to say, this is my home, this is my area, stay out, stay clear. So that is mainly why lions will roar. Can see he's panting very, very heavily there. It's very, very hot. So Julian has asked a question. Julian would like to know, how do lions protect themselves from other predators? So Julian, it's a good question, but what happens is that lions generally don't have predators that will try and hunt them. A predator is an animal. He's just fallen over there. Predator is an animal that will try and hunt another animal. So lions, the way they protect themselves from probably other lions, that would be their biggest threat, is they will do that territorial calling. And if they have to, they will fight one another. And that's biting, scratching. That's how they protect themselves. But they don't have predators as such, so which means they don't have animals that will go and hunt them. But they do have to protect themselves against other lions that might come into their territory. And they've got incredibly sharp teeth. And we might see this male's teeth again when he was panting. You could just see them. You can see those sharp teeth there. And Savannah has asked us a question. Savannah wants to know, why is the lion not running towards us? So Savannah, what happens is we've spent a lot of time in these areas tracking and finding and following these animals, and they are not afraid of us to an extent. There's mutual respect, so we don't try to get too close to make them angry. And we give them a little bit of space so they're comfortable with us being here. And because of that, they won't want to attack us. But we do still have to be careful. And also, it's very, very hot. So this male is not too interested in getting up and running at us at the moment. And little Sierra has asked us, do lions hibernate? No, Sierra, they don't. So these lions will move around throughout the year. They'll always be active. Most of our animals in Africa are active throughout the year. We don't have animals that migrate, except for, or mammals rather, we don't have mammals that migrate, hibernate, except for snakes. Snakes and reptiles, they will hibernate, but not these animals. So we don't have bears like you do back home in North America. So they would hibernate, but not these lions. So Madison has asked, how do we know if it's a boy or a girl? So Madison, if you have a look at this male over here, he's got a lot of hair around his head and his neck. Can you see that very, very thick coat? And that is a male. The females do not have that at all. And unfortunately, we can't see any of the females at the moment. They're just lying down. But I have got a book here, Madison, so let me show you. Let me just find it quickly and I'll show you the difference between the male and the female. There we go. All right, so have a look here. And there you can see that is the female, or the lioness, as we call it. You can see no mane at all, and very different to the male. And then you can see this beautiful big male right next to us, or very close to us. You can see that that mane that he has is much, much thicker. And the reason for the mane is actually to protect themselves from other lions. So because what happens is when they do fight, they obviously attack the neck. So they've got to have some protection. And that thick mane will hopefully protect them from other lions in case they do get bitten around the neck or the head. He's stretching a little bit there. Abby has asked how sharp their teeth are. So Abby, a lot of their front teeth are very, very sharp, but also they're just very, very big and powerful. So they can tear open food that they eat like a buffalo, which these lions have been very successful for the last week. They've been hunting a lot of buffalo. And they will be able to tear open the buffalo and eat the meat very easily with those sharp teeth. You can see how heavily that lion is panting, is breathing very heavily, and they do that because they are hot. It helps them cool down. So that's why he's breathing so heavily. You can see his stomach and his back moving up and down. Have a look there. You see that? So Rowan has asked us a question. Why do lions fight? So, Rowan, the only reason lions would fight, well, there are probably two reasons, two or three. So what happens is lions will fight if a pride bumps into another pride, because they will not be family. And the reason is then, have a look, this male's just standing up. They're just moving further into the shade. But you can see that lioness there now too. So what happens is these lions will fight one another if they bump into each other, because they are coming into their territory, so into their home space, and they don't want that. So that's usually when lions fight, especially males. The other time they might fight is if they're feeding on a kill. And the reason for that is, even though they're a family, the pride of lions would be a family or a group, if they are eating, we call it survival of the fittest. They still want to have more meat than the other one, because if they don't eat, they won't survive. So even within a family, they will fight over their food to make sure they get as much food as possible. So that's probably the two main reasons why lions fight. Still don't see the rest of the pride. Some Franklins calling in the distance, little ground birds called Franklins. A few birds calling, but it is still very hot, so not as active as they are early in the morning or late in the afternoon. We may hear and see a lot more birds later on this afternoon when the temperature starts to cool down. It really is amazing that we're able to get to see and show you these lions, because it's not easy to find. A lot of the time we spend hours tracking and looking for them, and even this afternoon we spent quite a while driving around here looking for these lions. But we saw them this morning and we knew they walked into this area, but we didn't know exactly where they were. So we do have to look very, very carefully. Wonderful that we can sit with them. We're going to stay around here and see what these lions get up to if they do move. So we'll stay a little bit. But while I do that, let's head back to Taylor and get an update from her.
We're not far from Cheetah Plains now, and we've come across a buffalo herd, which seem to be quite spread out. They're both far on the western side of me, and as well as far on the eastern side, except this little buffalo over here. Now, unfortunately, this buffalo is looking a little bit on the thin side, and that's because of the drought that we are experiencing. So we haven't had enough rain, and the buffaloes unfortunately haven't got enough grass to eat. Now, they normally eat grass, but you can see that this buffalo has decided to eat some leaves, which is not very good for its tummy, as its digestive system unfortunately cannot really digest the different proteins in the plants, which is not good. But I don't know if you can see the glistening on that buffalo's nose. Now, that's a good sign. Even though it's looking a little bit on the thin side, its nose seems to still be quite wet, and that's normally quite a good indication to tell how healthy a buffalo is, in combination with a couple of other signs. When it goes dry, it often means that they're quite sick. But eating too much leaves, unfortunately, can make them sick too. Now, Daniel, looking at this little buffalo over here, you've noticed that it's got big horns, and you're wondering, why do buffalo have such big horns? Now, they're a little bit different from the cows. And this young buffalo over here is still going to get a much bigger set of horns as it grows older. Now, typically the males have got big horns. It almost looks like it's a helmet on their head. And they need that big helmet so that when they fight each other, they can clash heads, so they run into each other and hook their horns. Also, those horns are for protection for the buffalo. So when the lions, which love to eat buffalo, try to come and catch them, they can try and fight them off with their big horns. But this little buffalo better catch up to mom. I can see her in the far distance. Now, it is tough. Nobody wants to use too much energy in this heat. That's probably why this little one is moving along slowly. It's thin. It's probably not as strong as what it was when there was lots of food around. And of course, in this heat, it's not really great too. They're going to be burning lots and lots of energy. Oh, it's hiding very well behind this tree. You can see it just there. Now we can see, can you see that other one looking through the bushes? Look at that, looks like a big male. There we go, that looks like a young male that poked his head around, just looking towards us. Now, Julian, you want to know, since we've been speaking about horns, why do they lock their horns? Sorry, excuse me, I've got hiccups and I'm trying to make them go away. So every now and then I have to hold my breath, but it's not working too well. So, Julian, they don't lock horns like, for instance, there's an antelope called a kudu. Often kudu will lock horns, the males will lock their horns and they get stuck. So sometimes the buffalo males, they can hook their horns and they get a little bit stuck, but it's not for long. But the main thing that they do with their horns is that they clash heads. So you see that big part on the top of their head that looks like a hat? That's called a boss, and that's the part of their horns when the males are fighting that they will connect with each other. So they'll run from a distance and then put their heads down and bash them together. It's so loud that it sometimes even sounds like a gunshot if it's two big males having a proper fight. But that's a young boy. He's still got lots and lots of growing to do. But let's go up a little bit further and see what else we've got. Maybe we've got a nice bird to show you. Maybe we've got even some of the smaller antelope, like a common dacre, which I'm sure will be around sitting in the shade. But I think that part of our plan today will consist of going to check all the different watering holes, because it is so hot. And hopefully, like I said earlier, we're going to see lots of different animals playing around. Have a look at this giant termite mound. This is a really big one. Look at this. Now, I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to go and very quickly stand next to it. Just want to show you how large it is, and then I'm going to come back to the vehicle. Now, tuck my little cable in. termite mounds can get rather big. And this termite mound is made by the large fungus-growing termites, which maybe we'll be able to see. But I just want you to stand right at the base so you can see exactly how big it is. Do I look tiny compared to this termite mound? I think if I had to climb up and go into up to the top, I'd probably have to roll back down. It's so steep. Now, looking at this termite mound, and you think that that top bit is very high, that is only 1/3 of the termite mound. So 2/3, so double that, goes underneath below the surface. And that's where the mound originally started. And as it gets bigger and bigger, they start to build it up like that. Isn't that incredible? Whoops! Almost fell over. My wonky ankles. Alright, let me plug myself back in again and we'll carry on going. There we go. Now, I'm unfortunately going to have to say goodbye to everybody at Windsor Oaks Academy. I hope you had a lovely time with me and David this afternoon. And maybe we'll catch you soon, sometime soon. But let's go back across to Byron.
And we are just, we've moved a little bit because that male moved. You can see these lions resting in the shade. They're not going to be going anywhere anytime soon. I still cannot see any sign of the pride, or the rest of the pride rather. Just these few lions here. But I wouldn't be surprised if the rest of the pride is possibly in this area. It is so thick and so dense, we can't move any closer or around here very well. So I wouldn't be surprised if the rest of the pride is possibly just lying down in the shade somewhere. Go ahead for Byron. I can't see the rest of the pride at the moment. I can only see one or two males and one or two females. I don't see any sign of the rest of the pride. They're not on the link. They're in the middle of the block between Mvubu and Galago Shortcut, right up against the drainage line. There's a little two-track that heads down from that link from Buffalo's Hook Cut Line, Galago Shortcut, and there's a two-track that heads south, and we basically south and east of that. It's quite difficult to get through here. So, you know, as you all know, we are in communication with some of the other guides and that in the area, and that's good because we let each other know when we do find stuff, and they let us know if they find anything interesting. So we just update each other often when we or all the time when we do find lions or leopards or anything interesting like these big cats. John asked us a question, and John wanted to know, do these lions form coalitions where they're not related? And John, that is true, they do occasionally. I've heard of it happening in certain areas. Usually though, coalition consists of lions where they're born into the same pride. Might not necessarily be the same mother. It could be two different females or three different females that give birth around the same time, but those cubs are all brought up together within that pride. So they are related because they're probably going to have the same father or the same dominant male that's mated with those females. Those males then form a coalition. Those cubs, when they grow up, form a coalition. They'll stay together. But I have heard in other areas where male lions meet up from different prides and they form coalitions too. I've never seen it myself though, but I have read and I have heard that it does happen. Ben has asked us a question. What bird is that in the background? Ben, I can hear two very clear birds, so I'm not sure which one you're referring to. There is a... The one currently calling that we can hear is called an orange-breasted bush shrike. That's the orange-breasted bush shrike. That's probably my best bird call. We always try to see if we can mimic some of these birds, and it's not that easy. There was also a cuckoo calling, a Diedrich's cuckoo. And that, the Diedrich's cuckoo sounds like it's going, dee dee Diedrich, dee dee Diedrich. And that was also calling earlier, so I'm not sure which one you heard. But I hope that answers your question to which bird was calling in the distance. Either that's the Diedrich's cuckoo. Dee dee Diedrich. And then the other one that's been calling non-stop is the orange-breasted bushrike. So I'm hoping it's one of those two that you heard. It's really funny trying to do these bird calls. Leroy has asked us a question. Can the lions regrow their teeth? So Leroy, I've seen lions break teeth, adult lions break teeth before, and no, their teeth don't regrow. I'm not sure when there are cubs, I think they possibly have teeth that come through and regrow as youngsters, but adults, I have seen adults with broken teeth and they do not regrow. They'll have that broken tooth or even a missing tooth until they die. These lions actually have a very good spot here, and I'll tell you why. Because we're on the edge of this drainage line. There's quite a deep drainage line down to our left where we are parked at the moment. And you can see that through there. You can see it's very thick, and you can see just down a little bit. I mean, look how dense that bush is, but there's a nice drainage line down there. But what these lions have done is they position themselves in a very, very good shady spot, as you can see. And because they're on the edge of this drainage line, they actually have a nice cool breeze coming along here. And because of that cool breeze, they are probably much cooler than we are sitting out in the sun. We have got a little bit of shade. Just wanted to show you something interesting. A little insect, I'm not sure, can you see it just there on my hand? It's a nice thing about hanging around in the bush like this. You get these little insects crawling on you every now and then. You know what this is, everybody? This is a baby praying mantis. That is incredible. It is making me twist my arm. Hold on. There, look at that. A little baby praying mantis. Wow, I had to look very, very carefully to see exactly what this is. You can see those front legs. Every now and then there it stands up there. Can you see that? There it goes. Look at that. And look how tiny that is. It just shows you, you find the strangest little creatures out here when you are spending time in the bush. Even when it's sitting with a pride of lions like this. Oh, that's great. It's awesome. It started crawling on Brian, and Brian passed it to me. I'm going to let this baby praying mantis go. While I do that, Taylor's made it onto Cheetah Plains.
We are safely here on Cheetah Plains, and we're making our way straight towards the southern boundary where we last suspected that we saw quarantine. Now, let's see, there's a couple of kudu around here. Now, let's see if anybody's willing to hang around. Probably not, though. There's one. I think she's going to dart in front of the road. Well, this is a lovely female. She still seems to be a little bit young. And there's a couple more adults on the left-hand side of the road who we can just see their rumps for the moment. You can see them feeding in the shade, which is a good thing to do. She doesn't even look like she's eating at the moment. Oh no, there she's starting to move her head. And there's a nice breeze coming through now. I wish it was a stronger breeze. Now, it's a bit strange at the moment, the weather. I think it's quite humid. David, do you think it feels humid today?
Yes.
It feels very humid. I know, Jimmy, you were wondering if it is a dry heat or a humid heat. Now, typically in this area, it's just a dry heat. But because we haven't had any proper rains yet, that humidity is building up. The soil is getting hotter and hotter. And hopefully, once we do have our first rains, it will cool down significantly. Hello, girl. It's okay. Having a little stare at us. Let me go a little bit further forward. And then those first rains will bring that humidity right back down to zero again. Look how she's giving us a stare. Isn't that lovely? Hello, girl. You could almost see down inside her ears. And they're lovely and concave. Very good sort of satellite dishes, that satellite shape to move them around and be able to pick up sound. Well, I'm glad she didn't run away from us. She just moved in to have a little eat and stand in the shade again. You can see those lovely white markings under the eyes. Very similar to what we see on the lions and leopards. And of course, that helps reflect light back into their eyes. But now, of course, unfortunately, the kudu's eyesight is not the same as the predator's. It's much, much different, in fact. And they don't really rely on their eyesight as much as they rely on their hearing. Look at this young cow. Have a look at her, how she's watching us. I think this must be her mother. Remember I said that this looked like a young kudu cow? And I wonder if it's perhaps not the offspring of this female from a year ago. She's not massive, but she's not tiny either. And it seems as though she was a little bit nervous and that mom sort of disappeared. But mom's keeping a close eye on the other side, but not really too stressed. We saw her feeding, so she's fairly relaxed. Oh, there, I'm hiding away. Oh, there's a couple of more kudu coming down. Let me see if I can go a little bit further forward and perhaps we'll get a better view. I think we may. Very clever of them to feed in this drainage line. I think once we get past these trees, we can look back into them. There we go. How's that, David? We've got a little view. It's obviously not the perfect view. A couple of leaves and things in the way. But I suppose we can't always have the best view all the time. Now you can see them both looking. They're not really actually looking at us. They're looking at the other female that's walking sort of in front of my vehicle and around it. And I think she's just taking a wide berth and she's going to come and join them down in this drainage. I'm so sorry, I've got hiccups again. And I'm really trying to get them to stop. I'll perhaps have to try drinking water upside down. Look at how elegant they are and how agile they are when it comes to moving. And always watching where they put their feet. You never really hear the kudu making too much noise, even when they are walking through leaf litter. And there's the other cow at the back. So it seems as though it's just the three of them here, a small group. which is probably why as well, why they get a bit on the nervous side when one of them disappears out of sight. Being in such a small group can make them quite vulnerable. Isn't that lovely? Right, let's carry on from these lovely kudu and see what else is out and about on this wonderful day. Now, something that we're definitely going to be following up on. Have one more look at this kudu. That's, sorry, David. Wendy, why are you doing these strange things to me today? Sorry. A few of you are hoping to actually go and have a look at that buffalo that we saw stuck in the mud earlier this morning. Well, I didn't think it was stuck. It definitely looked like it could move its legs around. I think it's just very weak, so that's definitely a place that we're heading to. Also, I'm sure we'll find some zebra around there. And look at the two crested Franklin that have obviously been disturbed, that are now about to cross the road. I think as this kudu went in to feed, she chased these crested Franklins out, who don't seem to be too impressed. But they've got the entire world. There we go. They can go and stand under the shade of another tree. Oh, but first a little bathroom break and a little dig in some elephant dung. Now I'm surprised that, oh, there we go. What have you got? Did you get something delicious? Maybe it was a little termite and some soil. So, sorry, like I said, I'm surprised that they're not feeding in all the fresh animal dung. That's another thing I want to follow up with this heat and with the dung being having so much moisture to it. I could only imagine that there'd be lots of insects around. And if I were a bird, especially a ground-dwelling bird like a Franklin or a spurfowl, that's probably the place that I'd be going to look for something to eat. But perhaps they feel a little bit like us today and not wanting to eat so much when it's so hot. There's almost nothing worse than that. She is an absolutely lovely kudu. Look how she keeps coming out. It's the same one that we saw. Hey, beautiful girl. She's very relaxed with us. Relaxed, but still keeping an eye out on the others behind us. All starting to look a little bit plump as well. Now I think that they're going to hopefully have some calves this year. Now this species of kudu that we're looking at is the greater kudu. And I know that Liz was wondering if there's any difference between the two species, or is it the same species with just different names? Excuse me. Now the greater kudu, which is the most common kudu that we see around in Africa, is much larger, much bigger horns, much bigger body size. And I believe that the lesser kudu tends to be a little bit fluffier. If I'm not mistaken, it has been a long time though since I've spoken about lesser kudu, I must admit. I think you can find them in sort of the Karoo region of South Africa, where it gets a little bit colder. And I don't think the lesser kudu have that beautiful big mane on their chest. I'm just trying to remember a photo. Perhaps I'll have to look in my book just to double check. But I think the males do lack that beautiful mane. I don't know if I'll even have it in here. I'll have to just very quickly check. Let me have a look while we watch this beautiful girl. Suppose I need to go to cave for kudu here. 243. I don't think I've even seen a lesser kudu before. Let's see if there's anything about it. I actually don't even have anything about lesser kudu in my little mammals book. Maybe even the area that I'm thinking about that I've heard of them being in there, maybe they were relocated and introduced. There is a lot of breeding sanctuaries down in South Africa and sort of the eastern part of the world down there. A lot of big game breeding projects. So that's possibly where I maybe saw a picture or something from, but I'll have another look at those kudu. Hello, Cassidy. So Cassidy is 5 years old and is wanting to know, why do kudu have those stripes? Now, Cassidy, it's very important for these animals to have different colors and markings on them. because it helps them camouflage. And this morning I actually showed everyone how easy it is for a kudu to disappear into the bushes because of its beautiful markings. So these stripes, these are called disruptive markings. And it helps break up the solid color. So all that brown, it helps break it up and helps it easier to blend into the vegetation to hide away from the lions and the leopards and maybe even the hyenas. That was something I saw quite a bit of down in the south, was that the hyenas seem to enjoy kudu quite a bit. They hunted them on a regular basis, and it made it quite difficult because the kudu would often alarm call, like they would almost alarm call for a leopard, and they do so for a kudu. And it just proves to you how good of a hunter hyenas actually are to be able to take down something as nimble as a kudu. There's quite a few little dragonflies and all sorts of things flying around today, but of course they never want to sit still. But maybe when we get to the watering holes, we'll see a couple of butterflies and maybe some more dragonflies, a few wasps. I can only imagine that they'll be down there, perhaps some of them collecting mud or just quenching their thirst. But this little spot that we have found is magical. With the kudu, some nice shade. I know that David is definitely appreciating that we're not staring into the sun today. But let's carry on. Let's try and get to some of these pans. Sorry, girl. I'm going to try and sneak past her. No, she's not having any of it, and she's going to trot on down to the rest of the family. How about, girl? But thank you for the lovely show. Wasn't that stunning? It's not often that we get to spend a lot of time with something like a kudu. Normally it's a quick glimpse. Now, we were chatting about their ears quite a bit. And the kudu obviously have those beautiful concave ears. And I know Aaron from New Zealand was wondering sort of what my opinion is about the kudu's hearing in comparison to the other antelope species. Kudu must have one of the best senses of hearing. I mean, we predominantly see them in the thicker vegetations along the drainage lines. This is obviously where they like to feed, on those lovely green leaves. And I think when you're living in the thicker vegetation, it is important that hearing is one of your best senses, because there's normally a lot of trees around, a lot of flitter on the ground. It's quite easy to pick up the cracking of a branch or the rustling of leaves if something is moving around in there. But eyesight is not necessarily so important, especially in the summer months when everything is so dense. Remember, all these trees out here, they get lots and lots of leaves on them. And sometimes you get thickets that are almost impenetrable, that you couldn't even walk through, that even probably an elephant would find a little bit tricky to navigate into such a thick terrain. And that's when you need the good hearing. So I think anybody in the Trachylarchus family, so the spiraled horned antelope, so from the bushbuck to the Inyala, that obviously live in similar environments, I think that they would have relatively good hearing as well. But sort of in proportion to the rest of their body, I think that kudu must have some of the largest ears. They almost, especially when they're younger, they look quite funny with their big floppy ears, and they haven't quite grown into themselves yet. David, are we still going straight? We're still going straight. Still learning cheetah plains. Well, I sort of know my way around, but I keep forgetting the name of the roads. But I suppose that's not too important just yet. As long as I know how to get from A to Z, that's all right. Oh, we've got some impala up ahead too. This is great. We're having an antelope day today. We've been having lots of days. We've spent entire mornings or afternoons with the various... I thought I saw Wendy. Wendy's acting a little bit on the sick side again. Sorry. So what I was saying was that we've spent so much time with the various birds and cats. We never really stopped to appreciate all the antelope. And sometimes they're just not around. And it seems as though they've been avoiding me for the past couple of days. And of course the impala always moving into the thicket, but that's okay, at least we can sort of see them through here. And all moving off. Now it doesn't seem like Cheetah Plains got as much rain as I think we did on Juma. We've already seen the grasses starting to come through again nicely. And perhaps Byron will be able to show you what quarantine looks like or any of the other open areas. But out here, it's still looking a bit dry and miserable. You can see them moving into the thicket, searching underneath the trees, underneath fallen logs, looking for any bits of green grass that are still around or somebody has missed. They're just carrying on with their day, heads down on the ground, trying to meet as much as possible. Let's carry on a little bit further though and see what's around the next door, or around the next shrub, I should say. Now, I was having a good chuckle this morning when I was on my way back from Cheetah Plains. We came across a couple of lizards in the room, but unfortunately they'd never hung around long enough. And now, Ben, you were wondering if it's too hot for the reptiles at the moment. I don't think so. I think they'd still be out and around. However, I think at 12 o'clock today, though, they probably would have hidden away. But now that it's cooled down significantly from what it was earlier, I think they'd be back out basking in the sun, catching the last rays of light. So that's something that we're looking for too, checking the trees, looking for any tree agamas. I've seen a couple of Gibbons geckos, some large-plated lizards, but once again, they're so shy, you've almost got to catch them as we're driving along like this. It's like they see the camera and they zoot on back into their holes or behind a piece of bark, and then we just can't get a proper look at them. But we'll keep an eye out. Maybe we will see some today. Especially with all the insects around, everything is going to start to come out. I know that Louise found a scorpion in Final Control. So that poor scorpion was probably trying to get out of the heat, and well, a nice air-conditioned Final Control, that would be a spot that I'd probably go to as well. And that's the other thing, and that's what you also have to be quite careful about when you do come on, if you ever get the privilege of coming on a safari one day, is that you have to be careful on these hot days and not to leave your doors and windows open, as nice as it is to try and have a breeze come through. If it is an exceptionally hot day, well, the reptiles are going to want to escape that midday heat, and sometimes, well, underneath your bed could be a very good spot to do so. So we were all chatting about it today, how we're going to have to start keeping our doors closed, otherwise one of us might end up with a little snake or something that's not wanted under our beds. So we're going right. Just double checking. Well, we're still making our way around to the southern boundary to see if these leopards are around. And I don't think they would have gone too far. Hopefully they haven't. And we'll just see, because the closest water, we're still going straight here. Yeah. Now, I was having a look at some of my photos from this morning of Nkanyeni, and I'll tell you why I was having a closer look. I was a little bit like sort of confused, I suppose you could say, but at one point I saw when we first arrived, I saw she had the big gash on her left shoulder, and then I didn't see the mark on her right front paw though, sort of on the outside of her paw, and obviously halfway through the sighting we saw it started oozing with blood. I was a little bit concerned by that, so I went back and to the first photos that I took when we first arrived, when Quarantine and Kanyeni were having a bit of a sort of a standoff when she was flirting slightly, and I zoomed into one of my photos and that gash is indeed there on the outside of her paw, but it seemed to be a little bit more closed. Now I wonder if that was not opened either by her licking on the paw when she was trying to remove those thorns, or maybe one of those thorns that she sort of pulled out of her foot, maybe that long stick hooked and then reopen the wound. Wow, let's have a look. We're at our buffalo, and I don't think that this buffalo is alive, unfortunately. Oh no, it is. I just saw an ear twitch. Now you can see it sitting here. It's barely breathing. You can see it taking a couple of breaths. And I did see an ear twitch. But like I said, it's very sad this buffalo is not stuck in the mud. It was able to move around. I think it has even moved from where we saw it this morning, slightly. But the fact that it is just so weak, and of course it's just trying to escape the heat, well, the perfect spot, obviously, is then to sit in the mud. But I don't think that this buffalo will last too much longer, especially after today's heat. I think that this is going to be the end of this poor buffalo. And we know how sad it is. But once again, it's providing a meal for somebody else. I think we'll leave this buffalo in peace, though, and we'll carry on a little bit. Well, we're not too far now from where we last saw those leopards. So I think while I try and find them again, let's go back across to Byron and the Nkuhumas.
So we've just got a view of the other male. He's come out into the open a little bit. Still, he's lying in the sun now. He must be very, very hot. Look how he's panting. I'm sure there are a few flies buzzing around there too. Look at that. So two males here this morning. We only got to see one male. And there's no sign of the rest of the pride. They've possibly just moved into the drainage line. As I was saying, it's very, very thick in this area. They're possibly lying in the cool shade, or in this cool sand rather, down in this drainage line at the moment. I'm glad we got to find them though, because it was a bit tricky getting in here. They are resting. I think they are going to rest for quite a while still, because it is very hot this afternoon, and so I think they'll probably stay here for quite some time and probably only leave much later this evening, early evening, as it starts to cool down, and then possibly go and find some water, I'm sure, because it's been so hot. Let's just have a look. The others are just off to my right. You can see them here. That's the other male and the female. Resting very, very comfortably. They're right on the edge of this drainage line, and I'd like to show you something quickly. This tree just in front of that male line. Let's see. Oh, well, those there, and actually all over here, it's got quite dark bark. And that one, and the one off to the right, and then we're actually surrounded by them at the moment. And why I say it's interesting is because all these trees are poisonous. It won't harm the animals in any way. But, and can you see this one right in the center of your screen at the moment? That's a young one, much lighter. The bark, so it can get confused, so you really have to be careful when you're in these areas. And I'll tell you why, is when you're in the bush and you need to make a fire, you never use the wood from this tree. This tree is called the Tambwerti tree, and as I said, it is very poisonous. So this tree always grows along drainage lines. They do need a lot of water, so they are growing all over here at the moment. So if you do find yourselves in the bush and you need to make a fire, whatever you do, don't collect wood near these drainage lines, because all these little sticks and branches around here are from the Tambwerti trees. The reason why I say don't make a fire with it is because these trees are so poisonous. The smoke, even just the smoke from the fire, if you inhale too much of it, can make you violently ill, give you a seriously upset stomach, cause nausea, headaches. And if you happen to cook on that fire, if you happen to cook your meat or anything over that fire, over those coals, with that wood, the flavor and the smoke goes into the meat, and you'll get incredibly sick from it. That's how poisonous it is. So we've got to be very, very careful not to use this wood. It's got quite a sweet smell when it does burn. But what I find very interesting is that animals in this area feed off the leaves off these trees. Animals like kudu and black rhino also love to feed on timbwete trees, which is very, very interesting. I have not seen black rhino in this area for quite some time, but they do move through the areas occasionally, and they are quite rare and endangered. But they happily feed on the timbwete leaves, which is interesting. It doesn't affect them. And like I said, the kudu too, they'll also feed on it. So their digestive system is obviously adapted to neutralize the poison from this tree. But we as people do not want to get near this tree and not want to use it to make fires at all. So be very, very careful. And like I say, it is tricky because sometimes the young trees look very pale and light compared to the older trees that are much darker. You've got to be careful. So we call this a timbwete thicket, and it's a perfect area for these lions because it is so dense and they're in perfect shade at the moment. So we've got a question from Zalo from Hong Kong. And Zalo wanted to know that the lions, he asked, well, you can see that the lions have very thin hair, and he wants to know, how do they protect themselves from sunburn? So Zalo, because they are covered in fur, they don't get sunburned, and they don't have bare skin that is open to the sun. So they do not suffer from sunburn. Animals that would potentially suffer from sunburn are actually hippo. The hippopotamus has got a very, very sensitive skin, and that's usually why they spend most of the time in the water, especially in summer. And they'll roll around in the water and cover themselves in mud, usually because their skin is so sensitive and they don't want to be caught out in the sun. And they could potentially get a form of sunburn. Not like we get, but they have got sensitive skin and they do have to be careful in the sun. The male still out in the open, and beautiful light on his mane there, that golden mane. Minas has asked us a question about the manes of the lions and the dewlap of the leopard. And I was saying earlier how the manes of these male lions protect them in fights from other males, because usually the necks and the head are attacked when they are fighting, so those thick manes help them. Similar with the leopards have got very thick necks, not quite the same in terms of protection because they don't have long hair. And Minas would like to know, what do the cheetah have to protect themselves? So cheetah actually don't have anything around their necks or heads. But also, cheetah are very different predators. And I say that because cheetah try and avoid confrontation at all costs. Usually it's more of a show, a baring of teeth. And they actually run up and stamp their feet very quickly. It's an interesting display. And they try and almost intimidate the threat rather than attack it. And if cheetah had to come into contact with the lion or leopard or anything, it would get seriously, seriously injured. The cheetah, to protect themselves from other animals, from other predators like lion and that, what they have obviously is their speed. They can run away and get away from lions very, very easily and quickly, unless the lions surprise them and ambush them. But they don't have anything around their neck to protect themselves from fighting with one another. And also, cheetah don't often get into a territorial dispute like these animals do, like the lions do, where they fight and potentially kill each other. as I was saying, it's usually a show, an intimidation, and then they may attack and fight one another, but it's not nearly as aggressive as these big cats over here. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to leave these lions. I'll tell you why, is they very, very rest, or completely resting at the moment. They're happy in the shade, and I really don't think they're going to move anytime soon, possibly only later this evening. So we're going to carry on driving around and see what else we can find. And while I do that, let's head to Taylor and see what she's got on Cheetah Plains.
No, there's that little stick in the way. Leopard streak. You ball. Yeah, I think it is him.
Oh no, it sounds like Taylor's got some gremlins with her at the moment. So we can't get through to her. That sometimes happens. You can imagine being out here while we are in the middle of the bush. Technically, it's quite difficult to always communicate with one another. So as I said, we're leaving these lines now, but it's actually nice that you can see just how we actually found them and how thick this area is. So you can dodge the branches with us. Watch out. I'm just trying to move through here. All right, it sounds like Taylor's got rid of the problems on the vehicle, the gremlins. So head to her, she's got a leopard to show you.
Now, we're back at the termite mound where we suspected that quarantine was. We did see a vehicle from Mala Mala parked here this morning. Now, I'm not sure if anybody can see anything just yet. Can you see anything? Ah, look who we've got still sitting on the termite mound. Mr. Quarantine himself. Now, he hasn't moved much at all. He's moved from the right-hand side of the mound to the left. He has really just been following the shade today, and I don't blame him after being chased around by Nkanyeni this morning, but she is nowhere to be seen. So perhaps she was happy with him as he moved out of her territory. And hopefully went back to find her cubs again. Now, he's giving a couple of yawns. Let's see if he grooms himself and perhaps if he's going to wake up. Here we go. That's what we like to see. But now, Mr. Quarantine, we don't want you to go further south. We're actually viewing him from quite a distance. He's not on our traverse anymore. So let's hope that he perhaps, maybe he does come back across the side to have a drink at one of those pans on the big open plains. Can we try and zoom into his eye on his left eye? Has he got a cut under his eye? Is that as far as we can go? Like I said, we're far away. What, I'm trying to work out if it's just a spot pattern or if he's perhaps got a gash under his face. Can you see that under his left eye? If you're looking at the screen, it'll be on the right. No, I think it's just those beautiful markings. Sorry, that for a moment looked like a gash. Now, it seems as he's come out unscathed, and it looked like Nkanyeni got a little bit of a hiding with her gashes. And of course that makes sense because Quarantine was well more than double her size from what we saw today. And he's really turning out to be a beautiful leopard. Remember in the beginning this morning we almost had our doubts as to who he was. Let's see if he comes back. Don't go further into Mala Mala, please don't, big boy. Oh, he's just laying down again. Let me go forward. So, Darby, there's another gap. I don't know what's that like. Must I go forward? Oh, more? Oh, no. Okay, we're just trying to work it out how we're going to do this. We're going to go back. I'm going to go slowly just until David says he's got a good view. Now this is a little bit more. No. I think we're going to have to get him through there, hey? Now, I know that this is not the greatest view. Of course, we've got lots of trees and leaves and things covering his face. But perhaps he'll get on moving again. He's moved once. He seems to be itching towards the end of the shade. Perhaps he's just working himself out to face the heat of the day. But he looks relatively well fed. He doesn't look particularly thin, and from what I understand, he seems like he's quite a successful boy. But he is looking lovely. I think this is definitely going to be a leopard to watch out for in the next couple of years. I mean, if he's sort of this size at 4 years old, he seems to sort of slim down when he stands up. He's not as big and as stocky as Tingana just yet, or Mvula. But I'm very impressed that he is almost 4 years old and he looks like this already. And doesn't seem to be too bothered by the flies like we saw Tingana was yesterday afternoon. He was almost having a complete meltdown and swatting the flies, trying to bite them. Whereas Quarantine seems to be a little bit more relaxed. Just the occasional sort of tail swat. He shakes his head and just tries to bite the flies.
No, I think if we go back.
Do you think we'll go? So David said he thinks if we can go back a little bit more, we might even get a better view. But let's try this again. Well, we'll see. We may have to push Wendy backwards. Right, let's try this again. That good? Oh, there we go. Well done, David. That's an even better view. But he's quite far from us. He's probably about 70, maybe 80 meters away. Like I said, he's right at the edge of the shade now. He's moved off that termite mound. And now we can only just sit patiently and see what he does next. Oh, and I was trying to have a look at what caterpillar it was that I found today, that bright green one. So thank you for sending all those screenshots through. I had a look, but it was quite tricky. I don't have a butterfly and moth book. I've ordered one and I'm just waiting for it to be delivered. And I'm not sure, still uncertain as to what it could be. I looked at the sorrels. They don't really occur up in this area, but their caterpillar looked very much like that. It could be one of the Acria butterflies, which is a very large family, and they've got a variety of different ones. So I still have to get back to you on our little green friend. Now, it would help if we found them on whichever plant that they would be feeding on. That would help immensely. But I shall let you know as soon as I figure out who it is. Perhaps I will have to borrow Steph's book. Now he's gone flat. Now you can see he seems to have gone back to sleep for a little bit. And Donna, you're wondering if we have any updates on Sandile. So I haven't seen Sandile yet, but I know that he has had his collar removed, and how exciting is that? Remember, we said we were going to do that as soon as it was possible. And they have indeed taken it off. And I believe he was seen around in Koro and on Cheetah Plains very briefly, a few weeks ago, maybe a week or so ago. But I haven't seen him for a very long time. I think the last time I saw Sandile was down in the south, in the southern sands, very far from home. But I think he's up and moving around in the area somewhere, and I'm sure he will probably pop around hopefully soon. It would also be quite nice to see how big he's getting. You can see the wind is now starting to pick up again. There's a bit of a haze in the sky, which is good for us. Hopefully there will be a bit of cloud build up a little bit later. Now I'm very thankful for this breeze now. Beautiful big sleepy leopard. And we probably will just spend a bit of time with Quarantine and see if he does decide to wake up. Hopefully the flies bother him enough that he does start moving again. And like I said, from here, the closest watering hole is actually on Cheetah Plains side, so hopefully he will decide to come back across here. You can see him breathing quite quickly though, trying to cool himself down. It's really beautiful out here this afternoon. Doesn't seem to be too much around though. I'm just sort of scanning the area as Quarantine sleeps. I can't even see Impala out on the plains. I don't even see Norman the Gnu just yet. Perhaps we'll come across some more buffalo in the watering holes cooling off. But I think what we'll do is I think we'll sit here for a couple more minutes and then I'd like to go and do a little loop and just check the watering holes just to see if there's perhaps anything in them or anything coming down to drink, and then we will come back to Mr. Quarantine. Because at the moment it doesn't look like he's going anywhere. Now, something that we were talking about this morning is the various identifying features of the leopards. Actually, we've been chatting about it now for quite some time. And thank you, Debbie. And I know someone else mentioned it this morning as well, on that beautiful landing strip that you are able to identify Quarantine with on the back of his rump. Let's see if we can get another view. And I think that that's quite unique. Remember, I sort of described him as a jaguar. There you can see, if you follow the top of his tail, and you follow it all the way towards the vertebrae on his back, you can see those sort of row of spots that have all, almost looks like they're about to join together. And I think that that is quite unique and it's quite lovely. Now, Kathy from Tennessee, you've asked a wonderful question this afternoon. You want to know, because Quarantine is related to Karula and a couple of other leopards in the area, will there be other leopards that will try to push him out, or is there not really a worry about inbreeding? Remember now, inbreeding is common with the cats. It is normal for a couple of generations. He's looking up, he's listening to the other vehicle that's coming on around. And it's all right. I think for the moment, I mean, it's Quarantine, and then of course his older brother Shavambalana that seem to be in this area. Sindile is a little bit too young, so he's going to have to live in and amongst the various females and other males' territories, I think, before he sort of finds himself. And I don't think Tingana and Mvula really come this far, so for the moment he'll be all right. I think the only competition he's going to really have is against his brother, who seems to be in the area occasionally too. But for now, he's fine. And it won't be too long before maybe he expands his territory slightly and then maybe he even decides to move out. Maybe he moves further south, maybe he moves further north or east. His future is uncertain. He's still a young, a beautiful leopard. But let's go back across to Byron, who has got a zebra, or even maybe a group of zebra, I'm not sure.
It is indeed a group of zebra, Taylor. Have a look, there's one there, and then a few off to the back. They are beautiful animals. They're enjoying all this green grass, which has just started to shoot out within the last week. We've had some good rain not too long ago, about 4 days ago, and already we're starting to see signs of some green foliage coming through and green grass. And these zebra being grazers, so they mainly feed on grass. They don't feed off leaves of trees unless they are really, really desperate. So they're looking for all the good grass, and that's what they found around here. Some flies bothering that one. Look at the tail. Their tail's constantly moving backwards and forwards, chasing flies away. And it's interesting. Sometimes, if you're lucky, you'll see zebras standing head to tail next to one another. And they often do that to keep the flies out of each other's faces. They'll swish their tails from side to side, chase the flies away. Look at those beautiful stripes. They're black and white. And if you look closely, this is very interesting. This is known as the Burchell zebra or the Plains zebra. And you can note, do you notice that little light brown shadow in the middle of the stripes? So that is quite distinct of the Burchell zebra. They've got the black and white and then this little brown shadow almost in between the two stripes. Some of the other species like the Cape Mountain zebra, which we do not get in this area, but they do occur in other parts of Southern Africa, mainly down in the southeastern part of South Africa. And their stripes are a lot closer together and completely black and white. There's no shadow between the stripes. So it's only the Burchell's zebra that have got this. Aren't they beautiful? Really peaceful afternoon, very quiet, few birds calling in the distance, but it's been very, very warm, very hot, so animals are just kind of taking it easy, I guess. They're looking for food, possibly. If most of them have probably headed to the waterhole already today, and a lot of people think that animals only drink either in the morning or either in the late afternoon, but it's not the case. They'll drink throughout the day. Whenever they're thirsty, animals will go and drink. And at the moment, because of that rain that we had fairly recently, there's some lovely little mud wallows and pools around. We'll see if we can find some for you. But then these animals are able to then walk past and get a drink, as opposed to having to find the big dams or big permanent water holes all the time. That little one running down there, and you can see this is a bit of a drainage line that we are in at the moment, so it's nice and cool. So Samantha has asked, why are zebras black and white? I can't see how these colors help for camouflage. So Samantha, it's a good point. It doesn't really help for camouflage, but I must admit, when these zebra are in the dense thickets, it does make it difficult to spot them. One of the main theories behind the zebra's black and white stripes, and I say theory because I don't know if it's really possible to 100% prove these theories, but one of the main theories, and the one that I think is the most accurate, is that when these zebra are being hunted by lions, for example, with a herd of zebra moving away from a pride of lions, when they're running, these stripes actually blend in. So when they're very close together, it makes it difficult for the lions to identify and to separate an individual from the group. So it might blend in and cause a dazzle, and that's often why they're called a dazzle of zebra. And that movement and all those stripes mixing and passing one another, it makes it difficult to see where one zebra starts and another one ends. So I think that's a very good theory behind this, the zebra's black and white stripes. Another theory was that it helps regulate the temperature, but I don't think that's very accurate at all. I think the other one is probably the more plausible. And if you do see a group of zebra running and moving together, you'll see it is actually difficult to see all the different zebra within a herd. Sharon from Illinois has asked us an interesting question. I'm going to try and move forward a little bit for you just to get another look at the zebra. Hold on. There we go. Now, Sharon from Illinois has asked us, why do the zebra have that black spot on the inside of their legs? And you can actually see it there on the front inner side of the leg. And now, Sharon, I don't know. I have no idea what that is for. So if any of our viewers have got an idea, I don't think it's a gland. You know, some of these animals, like a lot of the antelope species, have got these glands around their feet and legs, and that is to scent mark territory. I don't think that's the case with the zebra. I could be mistaken, but I don't think so. But I'm not sure what that little black spot is for, unless it's just a marking on the zebra for some reason. I really have no idea. So if any of our viewers do have an idea or do have a theory, please let us know. Hashtag Safari Live, send in your comments or questions at wildearth.tv, and maybe you can shed some light on it. Oh, I just had a little butterfly fly over us. It's very difficult to sometimes show you all of these little things because it does happen very quickly. It looked like a monarch butterfly that just flew past us. Let us carry on. I'm going to head towards Biffleshoek Dam. With it being so hot, I'm hoping that we get some animals coming down to drink or just in that general vicinity. I'm going to continue along this main road and head towards the dam. While I do that, let's get an update from Taylor.
Right, now unfortunately Mr. Quarantine has moved away from where we saw him. He moved further into Mala Mala. I think something caught his attention. Oh, hello Rolo. Let's see if this Rolo is going to stop. Now, which is a pity for us. It's flying off into the distance, as you can see. It doesn't look like it's going to land anytime soon, but I'll keep my eye open for that lilac-breasted roller. Oh, there we go. Here it is. Can you see it through there? But we'll keep an ear out. There's another guide there who's just waiting to see if he does perhaps return. And if he does, they said they're going to let me know, which will be exciting. But otherwise, we'll have a little scratch around and see if we can't pick up on Kanyeni's tracks and figure out where she's gone. I also don't think she would have gone too far. It was exceptionally hot today. And you see this beautiful lilac-breasted roller. You can tell that it's a little bit on the windy side by how it's having to balance on that branch. It's almost keeps to, going tail over the top of its head. And these are such lovely birds, and I'm envious of Brent, who got to see a broad-billed roller. I'm absolutely dying to see one of those, so that's something we're going to be keeping an eye out for. And these are incredible birds to watch, especially when they're flying around trying to catch insects or when they dive down to the ground and catch a grasshopper. I always think that that's quite amazing. That beautiful white supercilium, it almost looks like an eyebrow, which makes him so easy to identify, and off it goes. Right, that was lovely. Thank you, lilac-breasted roller. Did you know that I've only ever got one really good picture of a lilac-breasted roller, and that was almost 2 years ago. It was actually when I first moved up into the sand that I was able to get one. It sat right on the branch next to me. I could almost reach out and touch it. I could not actually believe my eyes. And I thought that as soon as I was going to pull my camera out, this thing was going to fly away. Well, it didn't. It just sat there. I was completely sort of blown away by that sighting. And of course, I didn't have any guests with me, which was very frustrating because it's one of the birds that everybody wants to try and get a photo of. Now, it's really nice for you sitting at home and watching because you're able to take screenshots, but it's so difficult to pull a camera out, get the focus right, or sometimes the bird is too far, you can't reach with your lens. My goodness. Jane, I hope that you are very well. Now, Jane, you want to know how many birds in this area changed their plumage, sort of, I suppose, for breeding purposes. Goodness, I don't think I could give you an exact number. I think that it'd be quite difficult. Oh, look, a little common daker. Did you see it just dart across the road? Wow. My goodness, that was not hanging around at all. That was so quick. And it's normally the sighting that you get is just the dust that they leave behind. Off, it's gone completely now. And sorry, Jane. So I don't think I can give you a number. I'd have to physically count exactly how many there were. And that would probably take me an hour of paging through each bush. But there's quite a few different ones. For instance, one of my favorite and one of the most noticeable is a bird that we were talking about yesterday, which is the pin-tailed wider. And actually, let's park in the shade here. I'm going to very quickly show you a photo exactly of what they look like, because it's quite, I think it's quite a nice example. Let's go to W, wider. There we go, 426. I'll say these numbers out loud, because if I don't, then I forget them. Okay. That was a little bit on the windy side. Just trying to get it perfectly. And so can you see the bird on the top left? That's the male, the pin-tailed wider. And like how beautifully it has been framed now, that's what they look like when they are not breeding. But if you go down a little bit, look how long that tail is. Now that tail, those feathers grow only just for the breeding season. We normally start to see them breeding actually at this time of the year, in fact. And of course, the female is not quite as attractive, but of course, it's got that little bit of a pink bill, which allows them, it sort of links them back towards the males. But a lovely looking bird, and something that I'll definitely be keeping a lookout for. But it's lovely, isn't it? Just trying to think off of the top of my head who else does that. But I'm going to have a little think about that, Jane, and try and see who else really changes their feathers quite nicely. Oh, my goodness, Wendy. Wendy's acting very sick again. And while I try and work my brain a little bit harder, let's go back across to Byron, who's got some wildebeest.
I do indeed have some wildebeest. The other plains game that we have in this area, and we call them plains game because they tend to enjoy open areas and have a look at these wildebeest that are enjoying all this green grass at the moment. You can see how lush this little section, this little patch looks. It's beautiful with this afternoon light. And they are enjoying feeding on this vegetation. It's interesting, usually you'll find wildebeest and zebra in the same area, and the wildebeest actually feed on the shorter grass and the zebra usually feed on the longer bits of the grass. So there's actually no competition in terms of food, and that's often why you do find them in the same areas. And if you think of East Africa, I know James was up in the Masai Mara recently, and you got to see some of that on Safari Live, and you got to see all those thousands of animals. And usually you see the zebra and the wildebeest all moving together. And even in this area, we don't have migrations here in Southern Africa. We do have some certain annual movements depending on food and water, but no migrations, and also not nearly as many numbers like you get up in East Africa. But you will get herds of wildebeest and herds of zebra often in the same area. And it's wonderful to see them. We haven't seen too many of the wildebeest around. I do think we're probably going to start seeing a lot more of them because there's a lot more food that is starting to grow for these animals. I wouldn't be surprised if these wildebeest came from the Biffleshoek Dam. We're not too far from there. Maybe went and had a drink during the day and now they're all feeding again. Look at that. They are very strange looking antelope, aren't they? Uh, And Paula has just sent us a comment, and I was about to say it, and Paula says, wow, these look a lot like buffalo. They do, Paula, they do look like buffalo, but they're not related to buffalo at all. They are completely in the antelope family. They're all part of the antelope family. The wildebeest do have a similar digestive system, though, to the buffalo. They are both ruminants, so kind of related. And ruminants are animals that have a four-chambered stomach. They have a very efficient digestive system, so they get as much nutrients as they possibly can out of all the food that they eat. But they are not buffalo at all. They are completely part of the antelope species. Antelope family, rather. One of my guests once told me, and they said, it looks like the wildebeest has kind of been put together with leftovers from other animals. I'm not too sure how the wildebeest would feel about that, but they are strange looking antelope, long faces. They're also known as gnu because of that very strange sound that they make. I don't know if I can make a gnu sound, but their alarm call, if they do have any predators around, or if the males are trying to challenge each other for territory, the males can be quite territorial. They'll give a grunting, snorting sound, which sounds a little bit like a gnu, gnu, gnu. And that's where they get the name gnu from. I'm sorry, my animal sounds are terrible at the moment, so I'm not very good at mimicking them. The only certain birds, maybe lion and leopard, I can get away with that. But we'll do that another time. So it's nice to see all these wildebeest around here. What we're going to do is let's leave them. We're going to carry on. We're not too far from the waterhole. And let's see if we get lucky and have anything coming down to drink. But really wonderful to see the wildebeest. Haven't really been able to show them to you in the last few days that I've been out in the open like this. We've seen one or two, but in dense thickets. Right, isn't that great? So let's carry on down the road. Let's go see what's happening at the waterhole. Leroy has just sent us a question. And Leroy wanted to know, what is the lifespan of the wildebeest? Leroy, they live up until they meet lions. It's difficult to give an exact estimate on how long these animals live. And again, because there are a number of predators and that in the area, I think wildebeest have a lifespan of around 12 to 16 years, somewhere around there. It all depends on food availability, water. There are a lot of factors that we do need to take into account when considering the lifespan of animals. But somewhere around there, I would say most antelope are within that range, 12 to 16 years. Maybe a bit more if they're really, really lucky and they do very, very well. Okay, let's see what we've got here. I'm almost at the waterhole. Just scanning around, having a good look. Maybe there's something hiding in the bushes around here. There's something in the water. Our resident hippo. And look at the terrapins sitting on his back. Wow, look at that scar on the back of that hippo. That is incredible. Now that would be from another hippo. It's not unusual to find hippo with serious scars on them like that, because hippo do have territorial fights on a regular basis, especially when water becomes quite rare and hard to find. Water holes start drying up, then a lot of hippo have to move into areas, and they then get forced to spend a lot more time in close proximity, and they can get very territorial. Males will fight for dominance, will fight for territory. Often younger males will get pushed out and they'll have to go and find their own little waterhole. And I wouldn't be surprised if that has happened to this hippo. Now the thing with hippo is they've got massive, massive teeth. They really do. And if they do fight, they can cause serious damage and sometimes death. They can kill one another if they are fighting. And it's interesting to see those terrapins basking on the back of that hippo. The terrapins actually play quite an important role with a lot of these animals. These animals that like to go and lie in the water or get close to the water, like buffalo, elephant, not necessarily, but the elephant do go into the water and bathe and splash, but not like, they don't necessarily lay in the water like hippo or buffalo. And what these terrapins actually do is they feed off the ticks. On the hippo, they eat them and pick them off these animals. So they actually play quite an important role. I think they're using this hippo as a rock at the moment just to sun themselves, warm up. Perhaps the water is a little bit cooler, so they're basking in the sun. Isn't that interesting? That one looks like it might slide off the hippo. Just changing position. It's very peaceful around the waterhole at the moment. I don't see any animals around here. Bit of a breeze over the dam. It's so nice, actually. Brian and I have really been commenting on the heat this afternoon. Very, very hot. And we've got a question from Ramblin. Ramblin would like to know, can the hippo see underwater? Yes, they can indeed, Ramblin. They definitely can. Now, in parts of Africa, hippo are found throughout Africa. And in parts of Africa where there are very deep rivers, the hippos run on the bottom of the water holes or the rivers to get from one side to the other. And they will open their eyes and they can see very, very well underwater. And as I said, they run on the bottom. They don't actually swim. The hippos don't necessarily swim. You may see some footage, if you're lucky, of hippos running. And then what they do is they kick off the bottom of these riverbeds and they kick themselves up. They do kick their legs a bit, but they're not actually swimming. Just to come up for air, and then they'll go down and run again until they reach shallow water. They don't stay in deep water all the time. Usually it's an area that they can either stand or lay down and just keep their head above the water to be able to breathe. And it's interesting, if you look now, we might see that hippo, his eyes and his ears. Let's see the nostrils. Where are the nostrils? There we go. Look how his head is flat there. That's perfect. What I wanted to point out is how all the important organs, his sense organs, the nostrils, the eyes and the ears, are all situated quite flat right at the top of the head, so that they're able to actually submerge completely and just keep that part of their body out of the water so they can hear, see and smell what's going on around them. It's a very interesting way the hippo have evolved over the years, so that they can stay in the water and still be completely aware of what's going on around them. But can you see that? That's actually wonderful, a wonderful pose from this hippo. Remember, So Melinda has asked us a question about how much food a hippo must eat during the day. Melinda, it's hard to say because it can vary depending on the amount of food available. Hippo are grazers, so they feed on grass, and usually what happens is they move out of the water holes in the evenings. They'll move around and they'll go and feed, they'll go and look for grass. At the moment there's very little grass around, so this hippo probably covers quite a large distance in the evening to find food. And I've read that they can cover anywhere between 5 and 10 kilometers in one night if they are looking for food when it is very dry. And judging by this area at the moment, there's not a lot of food around. But with this green grass coming out, the hippo's probably getting a bit more food. I'm not exactly sure how much it needs to eat, though. I think it's between 20 and 50 kilograms of food a day, probably, for a large hippo. But their digestive system is fairly efficient. It's not like an elephant that need so much food to keep those animals going. Oh, some of the larger animals, the bulk feeders like rhino or buffalo, they need to constantly feed. Hippo will rest during the day and then only go out and feed at night. So it's not nearly as much as those other large animals that we get in the area. We're going to move on from the dam. There's not too much else going on yet just at the moment. So we're going to drive around and see what else we can find. Maybe we can bump into some elephant this afternoon. That would be great. While we carry on our search, let's head back to Taylor for an update.
We seem to be having a lot of luck with the buffalo this afternoon. And I'm completely sort of flabbergasted as to the fact that we're not seeing hordes of animals around the various watering points. If you could only feel how hot it really is here today and how humid it was, well, if you were an animal, you'd definitely be hanging around in the water. But just a couple of buffalo and not too many elephants, just those three that we saw earlier today, those four that we saw earlier. And not even a footprint of any others. So that's quite bizarre, and that's something that I would really like to see, of course, is a beautiful big herd of elephants coming down to splish and splash. Now, we didn't have any luck on finding Nkanyeni. I had a look for her footprints, but she was on a serious mission this morning, and I'm not sure where she's disappeared to. So myself and David are actually making our way back towards Juma. But now you can see how desperate these animals are, how this buffalo has got its head tucked into the shrub. If you listen carefully, you hear a Deirdre's cuckoo calling. And that is definitely going to be a goal of mine over the next few weeks, is to actually try and capture one of these cuckoos on camera. It seems as though there's not really much grass in that little fallen over terminalia. And this cow seems to be, oh, not cow, it's a young bull, sorry, seems to be moving off now. Beautiful sounds though, all of a sudden. Very, very peaceful. And we're actually back at three in a row pan. Nothing really in the large amount of water, but we have just seen our buffalo again, who unfortunately, like I said, is not looking very well. I think we'll have one last look at this poor buffalo as we move along. And I think that by tomorrow morning, I don't think it will be around. You can see it kicking about a little bit. Very thin, very hot and uncomfortable. Very sad. Nature can be so cruel sometimes. Now, I know you're probably thinking, why on earth aren't we helping these animals? Sorry, I've got a bee here. The bee is gone now. Just came in to say hello. No, please don't come and sting us. And I know, Kim, you're wondering, why don't we help this buffalo? Now, where we are currently at the moment, we're in an open ecosystem. So basically, there is a big fence around the Greater Kruger area, but it's 8.5 million acres of land, which is a massive piece of land. And I apologize, I am looking into the sun. But it's very difficult for us to try and help these animals all the time. If we intervene constantly, then we do not let natural selection take place like it should. So droughts come along, they start to wipe out the herbivore populations, the carnivores obviously peak and they do very well. And then, well, in the greener season, sometimes the tables can turn. The vegetation is not in the favor of the lions, they're not as well camouflaged with other various predators. And of course, all that green grass comes around and all these herbivores are able to regain their strength that they lost from the drier periods. And then we have diseases that come around and actually constantly control the predator populations. So the only time we will intervene, unfortunately, or fortunately for the animals, is if it's an injury sustained because of human interference. So something like a snare, or perhaps if there were poachers around and an animal got injured, then we really are going to absolutely try and help it. Remember, yes, it's very sad that this buffalo is dying and probably won't last very much longer. But like I said, and it's something that you do have to understand, is that it's providing a meal for something else. You can hear the buffalo now slightly distressed. Sorry, I'm just looking at it and ducking from the sun. But I think let's move on from here and let this buffalo pass away in peace. No, we're not going anywhere. Wendy, please don't die on me. We're far away from home. Now, we're lucky that we had that other bouts of rain, because it is going to give the animals a second chance of coming back after this drought period, but we don't know when we're going to have the next set of rains again. We keep thinking with this high humidity that's building up, we're going to have to get rain soon. That's sort of the typical trend. As it gets hot, 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 it goes from a dry heat to a humid heat, and then it normally lasts for about a week, and then we get a big thunderstorm. And I really hope that sort of happens. We don't have to have rain every single day. Ideally, what we need out here is we need sort of constant rain. If we could get rain once a week or once every second week, about 20 mils of rain for the next couple of months, that would be amazing. It would just keep a constant growth of the grass and allow the grass to get nice and long. We haven't seen it once where the grass, well, I haven't since I've been here seen it once when the grass has sort of got to taller than our knees, and we have had a fair amount of rain, but the gaps between the rain has just been too big. The amounts that we've had, if they were closer together, definitely would have been enough to sort of fuel all the vegetation that's around. But even if you just have a look over here, the small amount of rain that Cheetah Plains did get is bringing some of that grass through now. But very slowly. Like I said, we had about 20 mils of rain a few nights ago. I'm not sure how much Cheetah Plains had. I don't think they had as much. Maybe they had maybe about 10 mils of rain. But I don't think very more than that. It seems as though Biffle's Hook actually had the most of the rain. I believe they had about between 25 and 30, which is great for them. So they seem to be quite lucky. And, you know, I'll tell you something very frustrating. When I was guiding down in the southern sectors of the sand, the property was sort of a figure of eight, and we had a northern and a southern section, the southern section touching down on the Sabi River. And there, it was the most bizarre thing. I'm just going to stop here because I know that the signal gets a little bit patchy if we go up ahead. We'd get these warnings on the radio, and I was guiding down in a lodge that was situated in the south. We get these warnings. Basically, managing director saying, be careful, there's lots of hail on its way, big thunderstorm, lightning, wind, you know, just be careful. If you need to, get back to a lodge when you can. And I'm good doing this, going, literally looking up to what we're seeing now, going, what on earth is everybody talking about? There's no rain, no clouds, no hail, no nothing. And in the north, guards would be racing back to the lodges, dodging thunder and lightning, trees that are blowing over in the roads, of course a couple of hail, stones falling down as well, and we drove around like there was nothing. And we were only maybe about what, maybe a couple of kilometers from the northern sector where they were getting all the rain. So it's amazing how things like that happen and the weather becomes quite localized. Which way should we go? Okay, perfect. I'm just double checking that the gremlins don't like to live around here. But maybe we'll go and have a look and see what's happening where the dam cam is. Maybe we'll get lucky and see some elephants around there. Now, chatting about sort of various animals that we haven't really been seeing in a while, the question I think we had this morning as well was about the Styx lions. Now, I know Daniel from Scotland was wondering where have they been hiding out because we haven't really heard anything about them. Now, I'm not sure. Like I said, I've only actually ever seen the Styx pride once, and that was on my interview. Not on my interview drive, but the morning prior to that I went out with Jamie and Jandre, and we went across to the Mala Mala boundary. And of course we had I think they were actually on a kudu kill, and back then it was still all 8 cubs. And unfortunately since then they have not survived, so I'm not sure where they're hiding around. I checked the sort of areas that they're said to have liked here on Cheetah Plains, and I haven't seen any footprints. I think I've only ever seen lion tracks once since I've come across to Cheetah Plains, and nothing yet. I'll probably have to try and get hold of maybe some of the Nkoro guards and see what they have to say, because I know there was one lioness who had some new cubs, if I'm not mistaken. I think she had 2. It'll be quite interesting to try and follow up and sort of see what's happening with them. So Daniel, I'll have to get on that and I'll have to get back to you about that question. Still just taking it easy, having a little scan around, seeing if there's not a leopard or anything perched up on some of these beautiful termite mounds that are in this area. My goodness. Now, I know we spoke about community nest spiders this morning, but I think that this is the biggest one I've ever seen. I just want to go back, and it was so beautiful the way that the sun was catching it. David, is that good? There we go. Look at how massive it is. That is a huge one. So if you remember from this morning, we had that long one. Hang on. Can you see the little caterpillar things? I need to jump out very quickly. Please excuse me while I hop out the vehicle. I want to go and collect a sample and see what's actually going on here. Because it looks very much like a spider hunting wasp. No, not that. Oh, and I'm taking my little blankets with me that help me sit higher in the chair. Not that I'm particularly short. I don't seem to sit very well. Let me go around quickly. I'm going to try and figure out what's going on over here. Now, I suppose I need a stick, huh? And you get a little stick to capture. Where are those little worms that we saw moving, David? No, they are. What is this? Maybe there were little worms. I'm going to try and get one out. I'm going to bring it towards you. I'm just having a quick little look around here. So, hang on, here's a live one. This one's been eaten. Caterpillar, it's your lucky day. Now, this is quite bizarre. I'm going to come around and show you. Well, if you look at this web firstly, you see how it's sort of blowing in the wind? Firstly, the silk is quite amazing. It's really strong, and quite a few birds actually use it to make their nests out of it. Now, if I turn it like that, can you see those caterpillars a little bit better? They just stuck inside the web. One is dead, which I presume has been eaten by the community nest spiders. And the other one, well, I'm not sure. I'm just going to turn it towards me so I can have a closer look and a little investigation. So perhaps they dropped down. I just want to see what trees are behind me from one of these bush willows. Maybe they're the larvae of some form of a butterfly and they were feeding on the bush willows and then unfortunately got stuck in the web of the community nest spider. Now there were lots of them in there, but unfortunately all dead and wrapped up in silk. Let's see if this one is still alive. Barely. I think it has been trapped in that web for quite some time. You can see it there as it stretches. Let me hold this silk a little bit. My hands are absolutely filthy from what I've been doing today. I must apologize. You can see that little worm. Okay. Well, it's good for the spiders, of course. It's another opportunity that these insects, we've seen an abundance of caterpillars and flies and alates at the moment. And as great as what they are, they need to start, obviously, pupating or burying underground, starting new colonies for themselves. It also gives, of course, the opportunities for the spiders, for any of the other insects that, of course, feed on these other little critters, an opportunity to sort of succeed as well. And sort of, well, I think we'll probably put this guy back, though I don't think it's going to survive. I think I might leave you on this. Let's see if I can save this little caterpillar. It's got so much silk on it. And I think it is tired and weak from being in the sun. Here we go. Little caterpillar, I'm going to put it down here. A little leaf. Hang on, what on earth are you? Wait, I'm going to pick something for you very quickly. It's astounding what you can find when you stick your head in a bush. What is that? Can you see that, Darby? Isn't that a crazy looking thing? It's fluffy, and I'm going to need your assistance again. Please, can you take some screenshots for me? And you can either hashtag Safari Live and add it to Twitter, or you can email it to us, questions@wildearth.tv. And I am collecting all the photos that you're sending me, so please don't think I'm not using them. I'm just waiting for a book that I can find to actually be able to identify these things. Now, I want to turn it around and just have another look for myself. That is a bizarre-looking caterpillar. Hey, isn't that incredible? Very hairy. It almost looks like it's got two antennae coming from the top of its head. What an outstanding little critter. We've been very lucky with, I suppose, with all the various insects. Now I need to put you back. Thank you for being so wonderful. You can stay there. Now let me jump back in. So many different little creatures around at the moment. You know, just when you think that you've got the knack of the bush and you figured out what all the little critters are, all the plants are, something new pops up and surprises you, and that's what we love, is that you're constantly learning. Right, we're going to go through a little bit of a dodgy signal patch now, so I think we're going to jump across back onto Byron's vehicle.
It's always interesting when you find those little bugs like Taylor's been finding, and a lot of them are quite difficult to identify, but it's great to see them. I know Steph is really great at identifying them, and he does such an amazing job when he's out on the bushwalks. We've been moving through this area. We've moved away from Biffle's Hook Dam. Haven't seen too much. Oh, look, everybody, quickly. Sorry, there's a little steenbok. There we go. Wonderful, a little steenbok, the smallest antelope in this area. And that's a little male. Oh, wonderful. He's hiding behind the tree a little bit. I don't want to move again because I'm scared I startle him and he moves up. There we go. Beautiful view of him. They're usually in pairs, so there's very possibly a female around this area somewhere, and they're one of the antelope species that mate for life. The pair generally stay together, obviously, unless the one of the two die, then they will go and find another mate, but they do end up staying together and in the same territory. Oh, look here, everybody. We've got a very interesting bird just off to our right. Brian will scan across. Have a look at this. Right here on the termite mound. Look at that. That's a Cokie Franklin. How beautiful is that? He may call again. I just heard one calling in the distance. There we go. What a wonderful sound. And these are very secretive little Franklins, so I'm so glad we got to see it. Thankfully, I don't have to try and mimic the sound because it's calling right next to us. That is wonderful. You often hear them, but they're tricky to see because they are small. This one has decided to stand right on top of the termite mound, and this is possibly a territorial call and trying to attract a mate. This is a male. I just want to find in my book quickly why I say it's a male and what I'll show you what the females look like, but let's watch him for a little bit longer. This is a wonderful sighting. You don't often get to see them, like I said, so it's really nice to see those beautiful colors. Very noisy little bird for its size. James has asked an interesting question. James would like to know, do all the Franklins have similar diets? Or is there a slight variation to avoid competition? There is a slight variation, but generally they do all feed on seeds. Some will even feed on insects, some of the larger ones, the crested and the Swainson's spur fowls, also fall into this family. They'll feed on some fruit bulbs, little roots and bulbs and seeds, even insects. These little Cokey Franklin, they'll feed mostly on seeds, shoots, and some little fruit. What I want to show you is quickly the difference between the male and the female. Let me just show you here quickly. Look at this. So I've got the book open to the Cokey Franklin, and there it is, and you can see this is the male with the beautiful red head, and look at the female, bit of white on the throat area and around that eye. Very different neck compared to the male. The body looks the same, but the head is different. So it's so nice to be able to see this male so close to us. Let's carry on watching him. If you were a photographer, you'd love this because it's beautiful light. William has asked, is there anyone calling back to him? There is indeed, William, and that's why I was saying that I'm sure it's going to call again. I can hear in the distance at least two calling back. So there are quite a few Cokey Franklin in this area, and I'm sure they're all giving their territorial call. This really is wonderful. This is one of the best sightings I've had of one of these Cokey Franklins, because often they just move off. They run into the scrub, into the long grass, and they disappear very, very quickly. Calling non-stop. One was calling back. I think it's a little too far for you to hear, but there is one calling in the distance. The other one has just called. So they're completely answering one another and possibly saying, this is my territory, you need to leave. And I think the other male is saying the same. But it's an incredible sound, isn't it, for this little bird? I think, why don't we leave this male to continue his territorial calls, and let's go see what else we can find. But wasn't that wonderful? Such a nice surprise, watching a little Steenbok, and all of a sudden this Franklin started calling right next to us. It was nice to see that Steenbok too. Often they run away very quickly. And he did get a bit of a fright in the beginning, but then stopped and we got a lovely view of him. Oh, the temperature's starting to cool a little bit. This breeze when you're driving is lovely. Yes, Andreen has just said that she thinks that's the best sighting of a Cokie Franklin to date. So I'm so happy about that. That's wonderful. That's good news. I've been really enjoying the birding over the last few days, the last week that I've been here. And I'm sure it will continue. There's some impala around in front of us, moving across the road. We've been seeing a lot of impala. Wonderful, wonderful antelope to have around. Elegant and dainty. And look how agile they are too. I mean, if you see them running at full speed, it's incredible. There's a few off to our left in the thicket, just behind the termite mound. I think let's carry on and just see what else we can find. It's always nice to see the impala, but we have been seeing a lot of them around, so it's nice to also just see them, leave them so we don't disturb them too much. Hang on, here we go. And buffalo off to the left. And while we're watching this buffalo, I got an answer to that question about that black spot on the zebra's leg. And Belinda said that the black spot is apparently called a chestnut, and it's remnant of ancestors of zebras. It used to be a toe, apparently. That's very interesting. Thank you so much, Belinda, because I did not know that. So it's called a chestnut. We've been seeing a lot of buffalo around. And the buffalo haven't been too lucky the last week or so. The lions have been preying on them. And they've been very successful. The lions have got a buffalo almost every day for the last 5 or 6 days. At least one buffalo a day. Some days they've been 3 or 4. And I think we've been speaking about it, and because we're coming out of a drought and we still need a lot of rain, we need a lot of vegetation to grow, but these buffalo have been weakened because there isn't a lot of food. So they're not in great condition, and I think it's become a bit easy for the lions to hunt them. You can actually see the ribs on that buffalo. Still exposed, but there's a lot more grass, so I'm pretty sure that soon they will start looking a lot better and they'll gain their health back and strength. Look at those very sharp horns. Buffalo are able to defend themselves very well with those horns. And they can be fairly aggressive if they do feel threatened. So I know I am very careful when walking in the bush because of these buffalo around. Because they can be quite unpredictable, but not just me. You know, even lions, when they are hunting them, they've got to be so careful because those horns and the power of the buffalo can cause some serious damage, and I've heard of many occasions where lions have been killed by buffalo. Usually what happens if the lions hunt a herd and the herd run away but then turn, and I've seen it before where the whole herd turns around, comes back and actually chases the lions off or chases them into a tree. Can you believe it? All right, so Taylor's back on Juma. Look at that sunset though. A beautiful sunset this afternoon. Clear skies, lovely silhouette of those trees. And let's just sit here for another minute just to enjoy that. Isn't that beautiful? Listen to the, I'm not sure if you can hear that. Cokie Franklin is still calling. Can you believe it? Still calling in the distance. But what a beautiful, beautiful sky. Just behind those few clouds. You really have had a wonderful afternoon. Lions and the buffalo and zebra and wildebeest, hippo in the water. We've seen so much. It's been a nice flowing drive. It really has been great. Interesting birds along the way. So we're going to carry on moving. Still enjoying the sunset, and as I mentioned, Taylor's back on Juma now. So let's get an update from her and see what she's got.
So our plan now, we're changing it up a little bit, and it was actually David's suggestion, is that, oh sorry, there's quite a few corrugations over here, let me go a little bit slower, is that he suggested, why don't we go and do a sunset cruise? And I think that is so fitting, as seen as you've just seen the sunset. Now we're going to head on down into this little dip, and then we're going to carry on, and well, we'll see who else is out and about. I suspect, I'm hoping, that we're going to see a couple of animals along here, just because it's been so hot today, as we keep stressing about, and of course it's nice and cool down in the drainage. So we'll just turn in here and have a little look-see. Right, into 4x4 we go. Go Wendy. Not allowed to get sick now when we're in the drainage line. And of course this is really lovely to see so many different types of trees. And maybe we'll get lucky and find that elusive cuckoo, which we have been looking after, looking for. Sorry, look, not looking after. And actually, let's take a moment to just appreciate the sounds of the cicadas. Isn't that absolutely lovely? The turtle doves shouting work harder, and then of course that high-pitched buzz that you get from the cicadas. Now it's actually not too bad this evening. I thought it was going to be a little bit louder than that, but when you're sitting in and amongst them on either side, I suppose the sound can reach about 130 decibels, which is very, very loud. Let's go along here and see who we've got. Come on, Wendy. You can do it. Should just rearrange my blankets that I'm sitting on. I find that quite funny that I need to sit on blankets because I'm not particularly short. I'm actually quite tall. But I don't know, the Wendy seems to have a sunken seat and I sink right down in it, and then you can barely see my head over the back seat of the chair. So they put me on blankets to raise me up. I think I need one of those baby boosters, you know, when you go to the cinemas and your child needs to see a bit higher than the chairs. I think I need to get one of those and perhaps sit in that. Now it's a pity that the fruit on all these beautiful jackalberries that we're seeing along this river have disappeared so quickly. But if you remember correctly, this is actually the jackalberry where we watched the other morning a go-away bird that was feeding on a couple of fruits that were still left, but they weren't ripe just yet. Now I can hear a Deirdre's cuckoo. I'm just going to have a quick scan for it. Where are you? Sounds like it could possibly be behind me. I want to jump out of the Mulwati very quickly and just go have a look. I'm dying to get this bird on camera. And maybe if I try hard enough, maybe we will. It's about a 4x4. We don't need to be in that anymore. Now, I think it's the same one that we heard calling earlier today because it seems to be in the same spot. Maybe it's living around here. Let's see if we can find it. Now, I wonder if it's not sitting in this big leadwood over here. A couple of starlings flying out of it, but I can't see the cuckoo just yet. But this basically sounded like where it was coming from, and now it has of course stopped calling. But actually, look what I've got for you. Can you see that weaver sitting on the tree behind us? Now, this is something I haven't... Well, I've seen them very quickly. Oh, and well, that's how you know we're live, is that when we desperately try and show you a bird, but before we can even get there, it's flown away. But it was indeed a southern masked weaver. Now, let's have a look. I'm sure you've seen plenty of weavers before. They make those beautiful nests. Let's quickly go to weaver. Now, it's a long list of birds. Southern masked, 420. I'm going to go right to the back of the book. And there's quite a few of them that we see in this area. You can see over here on the left-hand side of the page, that is the southern masked weaver. Now, they can be easily be confused. If you go to the right, the lesser masked weaver, now there's two birds they can be confused with, but you can see that the mask of the lesser masked weaver goes a little bit over the crown of the head and it doesn't have that red eye. And then if you go to the top, the village weaver, this for me is always tough to try and get them sort of right. You can see that the male, if you go further to the right of the page, has also got a red eye. But can you see how that black mask sort of cuts right above the top of the eye and doesn't go so high above the... I'm just trying to point over there. You see how it's lacking the crown, the black crown, whereas you see that mask completely covering the face on the southern masked weaver on the left. Right, but that's just... hopefully that will help you when trying to identify them. This is obviously only if you have a really good look at them. And it's understandable if you do get those three birds confused at a quick glance, if you don't get to see the eye color. But it seems as though that cuckoo does not want to be found just yet. It's fine. I'm patient, cuckoos. I'll get you eventually. Right, let's go around. I think I'm going to keep out of the Mulwati just for now, just because I know there's a little bit of a spot that... Do you have a flat tire? Oh. David looked concernedly down towards the tire and I thought we may have had a flat tire, but we don't. And let's go back across to Byron and catch the last of the sunset with him.
This is an incredible sunset, Taylor. I hope you can see it where you are. I know you've gone down into the drainage line, but an absolutely beautiful sunset. Nice bit of cloud cover, and always helps having the clouds around. And I always chat about it and mention, you know, this is usually when we'd stop our drive with our guests and get out, stretch the legs a little bit and have some refreshments. So if you're at home watching, wherever you are around the world, maybe get yourself something to drink and enjoy the sunset with us. It's so relaxing, so peaceful. There's a nice little cool breeze that's just picked up. The temperature's dropped. It's very peaceful. A few birds calling in the distance. A Cape turtle dove. Really is wonderful. And you know, stopping like this at times also helps a lot to find animals, because we might hear something. Maybe the call of a leopard, a territorial call, or an alarm call from some antelope or birds or monkeys. We could potentially find something else. And also, the amount of times I've stopped for our sundowners, or just to enjoy a sunset or a sunrise, and something's wandered out of the bush. Oh, I can hear some zebra. Don't know if you all got to hear that, but there was some zebra calling in the distance. A little bit far away. Sound of a zebra. I have got some other good news though. My dear old friend James is back. He's returned from his leave, so he'll be back on safari with us from tomorrow. It's great to have him back. He looks well rested, and sounds like he enjoyed his birthday and his time off. So I'm sure all of you are also excited to have him back. And I'm sure we're going to have some more fun over the next week or so that I'm still here too. And look what's just landed in the tree next to us. A vulture. It's just got its head tucked away. A white-backed vulture. Enjoying the sunset with us. Well, that sun is just dropping now on the horizon. Have a look at that. Oh, really incredible. That mountain range that it's dropping behind is called the Drakensberg Mountain Range. It's the largest mountain range, which stretches almost right across South Africa. But look how quickly that sun drops. Once it gets to something that we can see it against, you really notice how quickly it moves. It gives good perspective. And gone. That color will probably stay in the sky for quite some time. Beautiful orangey red. Wasn't that lovely? So great to sit and just watch the sun go down. So peaceful, so relaxing. We're going to carry on in our search for anything interesting. And while I do that, let's get another update from Taylor.
Now that sunset looks absolutely beautiful this afternoon. I'm just getting a couple of snippets of it between all the trees. Unfortunately, we don't have a clear view of it, and I'm envious that you got to watch it. So hopefully you all took a couple of good screenshots that I can go back and have a look at. Now we're currently on our way towards the Juma Pan, so you can have a look, and I shall pretend to be the dam cam for a little bit longer. But we're not too far, we're probably only a few hundred meters away, so this is going to be quite exciting. And then we'll also be able to have a look and see how nice and green the grass is. Just checking around here. And I wonder when Karula is going to come back with her little ones. It would be so nice to see her back in the area again. Maybe tomorrow morning. Let's see if I dream about leopards tonight. Though I am also missing the Nkuhumas, so I suspect I'm probably going to have to try and find them again at some point in the next couple of days. My leopard streak has been absolutely wonderful. I think it's time for a change and hopefully we'll see some lions. You all know how much I love those Nkuhumas. Now, I believe, and I'm so excited that we're on day 50 of our cat streak. Isn't that absolutely incredible? And I loved how we weren't seeing any leopards at all for quite a few days, and then we got to see four different leopard in such a short space of time, in 2 days. Isn't that incredible? Right, we've arrived, we're almost there, and I can see lots and lots of wildebeest on the lovely green plains, just sort of south of the dam. Let's have a little closer look. Going to reposition ourselves. And I wonder if Henry's around. Henry, are you here today? Look at how stunning this is. I'm just going to go up a bit further. Get us a nice spot that we can look back onto these wildebeest. Isn't this stunning? With, of course, that beautiful light that's sitting at the back in the distance. And then, of course, all these wonderful wildebeest that are walking around. Now, it almost looks like they're all walking uphill, but don't worry, it's just sort of the gradient of the ground. And this is one of the bigger herds of wildebeest I've seen since I've been here. We've seen a couple herds, but sort of few and far between. So it's quite nice to see all these females and, of course, a couple or one impala. Lost and amongst the wildebeest. Looks like it's looking for the rest of its herd. There's a couple at the back. And to whichever male wildebeest lives in this area, well, he must be smiling from ear to ear, having all these lovely ladies around him. There's even a couple of guinea fowl further to the left, where the logs are. There's so many different animals here. And for a change, the guinea fowl are being quiet. You can see they're all grooming themselves, doing one last forage before the sun sets, and then I suspect they're going to pick a tree and fly up to it and roost there for the evening. You can see all the wildebeest again, all the youngsters, and all the females look like they're getting rather large bellies. And I wonder which animal species it's going to be first this year, that we're going to see the first baby. Is it going to be a wildebeest? Is it going to be an impala? I wonder what your guesses are. I'd like to hear what guesses you think as to who we're going to see the first baby of the season from. Whether it's a zebra, wildebeest, impala, kudu, you name it. I think it's going to be, this is a tough one. I want to say impala because they're the most abundant, but then I also want to say a zebra because sometimes they're sneaky. And they can have their foals a little bit earlier. I'm going to go with the zebra. I think we're going to see a baby zebra, a foal. That will be the first one. That's lovely. I'm going to move up towards the dam, though. Let's see what's going on inside there. There's a couple of beautiful big waterbuck, which we're going to have a look at as well. They're standing right up along the fence, though. Let's have a look at those waterbuck in the distance, especially that big male that's now turning towards us. Oh my goodness, look at those horns. Now, if you're watching for the first time and you're wondering what on earth that fence is at the back there, that is just a very small electric fence that is going around one of the lodges to try and keep as many of the larger animals out as possible, but it doesn't always work. I'm pretty sure that most of the antelope could actually just jump over the top of that fence if they really wanted to. They're very athletic and are able to leap over quite a few different things. Though I wouldn't imagine too many antelope species would want to go in there. However, the Inyala and bushbuck that often feed on all the vegetation around the lodges and they become quite easily habituated, they often pop inside. Like I said, they've got springy legs and they're able to jump over. Now, that's quite interesting to see two big males. This one that we're looking at now, though, looks much larger. And there's actually even a third one a little bit further to the left. There he is there, and he looks like a giant. Look at him. My goodness, that is a big waterbuck. Now, I wonder if there aren't a couple of females around, and that's why they're hanging around, slowly moving in, and they will probably start the courtship process and fighting amongst each other. But I think what we're going to do now is we're going to go back across to Byron, who I believe has an elephant.
I do indeed have some elephants, and we actually mentioned it not too long ago. I said maybe we bump into a herd of elephant, and we have. And I'm so happy. Sun has set, and they're moving through these thickets, feeding. There's a few of them around. What I'm going to do is, I think this road bends a little bit to the bottom. There's a little bit of a dip in front of us, I should say. And then I think it bends a little bit to the left. So let's go have a look and see if we can't see the rest of this herd. But isn't that a lovely surprise? It looks like a few females with some younger elephant. But I didn't see the rest of the herd. They've moved, like I said, down into this drainage line. Let's see if we can't get a glimpse of them. Ah, yes, there we go. I see a few of you hiding in here. Wonderful. Look at this, everyone. Oh, there's a whole herd. Look at that. Wonderful. Andrew's just asked, what happens when the matriarch of the herd dies? Who will then become the next matriarch? So there is a hierarchy. It is most likely an elephant that is related to the matriarch, perhaps one of her offspring that's old enough, or maybe even a sister of that matriarch. The oldest and wisest within the herd usually becomes the matriarch. Oh, wonderful. Hang on, let's follow them a little bit more. They're not moving too quickly. We'll get a nice view, I think, just down here. We might get a nice view of them again. Just make sure there's not another one coming behind us. I don't see any. Seem to be enjoying all this vegetation down in this drainage line. Oh, sorry, I'm just gonna edge forward slowly and not to disturb them, but they seem happy with us being around here. There we go. Isn't this fantastic? My absolute favorite, to be able to sit and watch elephant like this. I'm so happy. Oh, this is really fantastic. Some youngsters here, a lot of females. And the younger elephant in all ages and sizes. Oh, that little one just having a look at us. Teenager, it looks like. Another younger elephant there. It's interesting to see when these elephants go and feed. As soon as the adults head to one tree, usually the younger elephants follow and they'll go and feed on the same tree. And I think that's how they learn. It's part of the learning process. They'll follow the adults and learn from them. That one dropping dung. So the elephant digestive system is not very efficient. So a lot of food they feed on passes straight through them. That's a young male. And they only absorb about, if I'm not mistaken, it's about 30% of all the food that they actually eat. So that dung is very, very coarse, and you can see a lot of plant material, grass, branches, bark, leaves. You can see the flies and little midges are around that dung already. It's incredible how quickly they all, but look there, you can see sticks. Everything in that dung. Some of the food passes right through, and we'll see fairly shortly Watch this young male. Nah, he's relaxed, just backing up a little bit. So we'll see very soon. We're going to start getting all the marula fruit on the marula trees as we move into summer, and elephants love it. They absolutely love it. We can eat it too, rich in vitamin C, very tasty. But why I'm mentioning it is because the elephants love it so much. When they feed on that marula fruit, you'll often find piles of elephant dung completely full of the marula fruit, and some of them pass straight through, haven't even been crushed down or bitten into. They literally just swallow them and they pass straight through the digestive system. You might get other animals will come and feed on that again. So especially monkeys and baboons, bird species perhaps, will come and feed on those marula fruit. Yeah, interesting comment by William. He was saying it's interesting to see how that elephant avoided stepping in his own dung. It was interesting, William. And, you know, they are very, very aware. Oh, there's a little dung beetle on there already, right in the middle. I thought I saw a little dung beetle walk down. There's some flies on there too. See those big flies? I'm sure I saw a little dung beetle just walk right underneath that pile of dung. So yes, William, very interesting to see that elephant avoid its dung and not step in it. Samantha has asked us, do the elephants migrate out of this area and sometimes during the year? No, Samantha, they don't. And the reason is because we are in a game reserve, which is protected and it is fenced, but it is a very large area. As I was saying, it's roughly around 7 million acres of land that we are situated in. So it is a huge area. But in southern Africa, we don't have migrations because there's generally always enough food and enough water for the animals. They don't have to migrate. These elephants don't have to. Up in East Africa and other parts of Africa, the elephants do migrate to an extent to go and look for food and look for water, depending on the dry seasons and where the food is available. So here, no, they don't. But in other parts of Africa, yes, they do. Just going to move forward a little bit again and see if we can't get another view of them from this side. They're slowly moving around. They've spread out a little bit more. Bush Mum has just said, what a lovely and gentle way to end the drive. So good for the soul. And I could not agree with you more. Look at this little one. Isn't that wonderful? It's been a great way to end. We had a beautiful sunset, very calm, peaceful sunset. And now this herd of elephant, completely relaxed and feeding around us. This little one gave half an attempt at a trumpet, just breathing quite heavily through its trunk. It's so funny, sometimes you get quite a reaction from these little ones. They do react to the vehicles and they try and show off a little bit. And I've seen them come rushing out and shaking their ears and then quickly turn around and see if mom is still behind them. They're quite brave when the adult females are close by, and then they usually just scurry off again. Trying to keep quiet so you can hear. I hope you can hear some of these branches breaking and these elephants picking off the leaves. lovely to hear these sounds. We've got a few birds calling in the distance, giving their last calls for the afternoon or for the evening. Ah, listen to that. Some Franklins, sounded like some arrow-marked babblers. Yeah, we're sitting in a drainage line and there's no breeze down here, so it's very, very warm still. Temperature is quite hot. Isn't this wonderful? So great just to be able to sit here and spend time with the elephant. Promise you, this is one of my happiest moments, just enjoying the bush and letting things happen around us. It really is fantastic and I do enjoy it. And it's so great that we are able to show you this and that you can join us and send your comments and questions through. I've always said this is a very different experience for me. I still guide a lot of guests around and I'm used to everybody being on the vehicle with me. So it's a little bit easier because you don't have to describe every little thing because they can look around, see, smell, touch. And it's interesting to be able to describe what we are experiencing through a camera and through to all our viewers. It's nice that you're still being able to see it and you can hear it. But being here is very different. Just having a look, just constantly watching the herd, just making sure. But they are so relaxed, they're not worried about us at all, completely comfortable. There's still one or two feeding off to our right. And they're slowly moving up this little embankment, looking for some more food. And they'll constantly feed throughout the night. They'll just carry on feeding. Can imagine they need a lot of food to keep those large bodies going. And we've spoken about it before, some of these big males will eat up to 250 or 300 kilograms of food a day, which is amazing if you think of how much plant material that actually is. Nita, thank you so much for your comment. You said you'd love to have me as a guide. Oh, that would be great. Maybe one day I can take all of you on safari. Look how that elephant's rolling that branch in its mouth and stripping the bark off and feeding on the bark. Look at that view. Just lovely with these beautiful big trees around us. There's still a little bit of light in the sky. The remains of that wonderful sunset that we had. All these wonderful silhouettes around us. Isn't that incredible? We're going to continue. I'm going to get the spotlight out and see what we can find with the spotlight. While I do that, Taylor's still at Jumapan, or Via Telepan. Let's see what she's got.
I was hoping we were going to see Henry the hippo when we initially first got here, but as you can see, he's not around at the moment. He's probably been out, already gone out for an early dinner. And I think what we're going to do is we're going to leave the dam cam. Doesn't seem to be too much happening here at the moment. Actually, look at the guinea fowl, how they've gone up to the top of that knob thorn. Now one has already flown up. Look at these two looking. Let's see if they're going to fly up and start the roost as well. They're thinking about it. Goodness gracious. There's some elephants shouting in the very far distance. So there's a guinea fowl up on top of that knob thorn. There it goes, look. There we go, starting a trend. The two are up there now, and I suspect that the third guinea fowl, there it goes. Up it goes. See, they fly exactly like chickens, not very well. It's not graceful like an eagle, unfortunately, but they can only do the best with what they've got. And well, they don't need to fly far. They just need to be able to get away quickly, I suppose, if something is chasing them. And to be able to fly just a couple of meters off the ground, well, that's perfect. And this is where I think that they're going to sleep tonight. It's getting settled in quite nicely. Here we go, guinea fowl. That's a lovely branch to sit on. Right, well, we're going to carry on now. I'm also going to get the spotlight out. Oh, I'm so glad, Fran and Linda, that you have reminded me. I completely forgot. Right, now, remember yesterday I was telling you about how we should do leopard impersonations. Right, now, I've been dying to do this, and it keeps sort of popping out of my mind, which is frustrating. So we're going to do it now, and we need to challenge Byron too. So, let me get prepared for this. Even David stretching his neck out a bit there. Right, let's just make sure. Now, I'm going to attempt to do the rasping of a leopard. Be interesting to see what you think. Are you ready? Is your volume turned up nice and loud? What did you think? I got a round of applause to David. David, I would have preferred a standing ovation. No, I'm just teasing. I'm being cheeky now. Ah, thank you, Kirsty. Kirsty says I get 10 out of 10. Now, that was my grand finale, and I hope you had a wonderful time with us this afternoon. And luckily, we managed to get a little sneak peek of quarantine before he disappeared. Well, and hopefully I'll see you bright and early tomorrow morning on the Sunrise Drive. But from myself and David, have a lovely evening, morning, night, afternoon, lunchtime, wherever you may be in the world. But let's go back across to Byron, who I know also wants to say goodbye.
So I just heard a leopard call, everybody. It sounds like it's quite close by. I'm just joking. That was Taylor's attempt at a leopard. Well, apparently it sounded quite good. So I know she's challenged me. So let's see if I can do a quick leopard call for you. So I'm obviously going to do a male leopard. And I think, like I said, I think my lion and leopard calls are a bit better than my bird calls. So male leopard call, walking territorial call. How's that? Oh dear. Yeah, I think Kirsten's a bit biased. She gave me a 6 out of 10 and Taylor 10 out of 10. Oh dear, oh dear. And River has just sent me a wonderful comment. River, thank you so much. You said, I'm your favorite. Thank you, River. And I'm glad you're enjoying Safari Live with us. And it is wonderful that you can watch. And River's age 9. It's so great that young kids are able to enjoy it with us. Trying to look for a chameleon just before we run out of time. But thank you so much to everybody. I hope you've enjoyed the afternoon with us again. Really has been great. I've enjoyed it. It's been hot, but it has been fun. And that's the most important thing. As long as we have a bit of fun out here while we're doing this, it's great. Scanning very, very carefully. Maybe an owl or anything just before the show ends. A big thank you to the ladies in FC, Kirsten and Lou. Thanks, ladies, and the voices in my head. It's always great having you backing us up back at the FC. And always a big thank you to Brian and the Thumb. Thank you, Mr. Hedgehog. this afternoon. And don't forget to join us on our safari, our sunrise safari, tomorrow morning again. And James will be back, which is exciting. Thank you, everybody. Good night and goodbye, and we'll see you tomorrow.